In today's video, I will be explaining the important role of the autonomic nervous system and how we can use the vagus nerve to our advantage for better health. There's been lots of attention lately on the vagus nerve and the autonomic nervous system, as awareness is slowly growing about autonomic dysfunction, POTS, and long COVID. More people than ever are focusing on their nervous system and looking at ways of rebalancing it. We know that a healthy nervous system is associated with lower levels of inflammation, more energy, feeling more relaxed, getting better sleep, and just feeling your best in general. But what exactly is the autonomic nervous system? What are the branches of the autonomic nervous system? And most importantly, how can we use this knowledge to our benefit? How can we access the power of this knowledge to improve our health? I will go over all of this in today's video. So first up, what is the autonomic nervous system? Your autonomic nervous system is part of your nervous system. You can think of it as the automatic part that controls involuntary actions, like your digestion, your breathing, your blood pressure, your heart rate, the background processes that we're not aware of most of the time. The two main branches of the autonomic nervous system are the sympathetic and the parasympathetic. The sympathetic you could think of as your body's fight or flight state. I'll go into this in an example in a little while. And the parasympathetic is the body's rest and digest state. I'll use an example to better illustrate this. Let's say a car is coming at you at full speed. You quickly get out of the way, and you're probably not even realizing that you're doing so. What is actually happening is the sympathetic nervous system, aka the fight or flight, is directing the body's rapid and voluntary response to this dangerous situation. So you'll have a flash of hormones that will boost the body's alertness and heart rate. It will send extra blood to the muscles so you can actually get out of the way. Your breathing will get quicker. You'll get fresh oxygen to the brain, and you'll have an infusion of glucose that will be shot into the bloodstream for a quick energy boost. This is wonderful, and the body's doing it so you can get out of dangerous way as quickly as possible. Everything's kind of getting optimized for fight or flight mode. Now, as I said before, this response occurs really quickly. You might not even notice it. But once you're in this mode and you've gotten out of the danger of the car not running you over, you now need a way to de-escalate the situation. And that's where the system encourages the body to rest and digest, parasympathetic mode. Your blood pressure, your breathing rate, and even your hormone levels kind of return to normal as the body settles into an equilibrium. The sympathetic and the parasympathetic system work together to maintain this baseline and to maintain normal body function. So we never, if you could think of it kind of as, you know, the parasympathetic and the sympathetic, you never wanted to tilt too much in either direction. You're always kind of trying to remain at baseline. And that's how the body is always kind of trying to, that's why it's trying to always kind of do this. When the two systems become unbalanced, it leads to serious consequences. And to prevent this from happening, you want to make sure that your body is operating with the right balance of both of the systems. So that's the optimal situation. But in many illnesses, there is an imbalance in the system. So you're kind of leaning. And that's where the word dysautonomia comes in. Dysautonomia, or as it is also known, autonomic dysfunction, is a condition in which the autonomic nervous system does not function properly. Now, much is still unknown about this, but in some people, for example, it happens after trauma to the body or something like an infection. I have a form of dysautonomia called postural orthostatic tachycardia syndrome, also known as POTS. But conditions such as POTS, chronic fatigue syndrome, long COVID, fibromyalgia, they're all associated with autonomic dysfunction. Even conditions such as major depressive disorder are associated with autonomic dysfunction. And as research continues into this field, it will be interesting to see what other illnesses will be linked to this. Common symptoms of autonomic dysfunction might be dizziness, palpitations, fatigue, nausea, weakness, chest pain, body temperature regulation, etc. There's lots of varying symptoms. When I was first diagnosed with POTS and I found out about this fight or flight and rest and digest state, it helped me make sense so much of why I always felt like a tiger was chasing me, these bodily sensations. Now, you might be thinking, well, a lot of these sound like anxiety, like what anxiety feels like, but it's not. This felt for me much more like it was in the body versus when my anxiety felt much more like it started from me thinking about something or much more kind of in my head. this is also what makes this condition and these kind of conditions so difficult to diagnose. There's really vague and common symptoms spread out all over the body, and it can be very difficult to identify and treat them as a result. And there's also a lot of different organs that are affected. Now, as I mentioned, I felt like I was kind of in fight or flight all the time. And the problem is the body is not designed to be in this state for long periods of time. Let's say with the example from before that a tiger is chasing you. As that is happening, your body is not focusing on digesting or detoxing or even boosting the immune function. If you know that you're dying tomorrow on the battlefield because you're going to be captured by this tiger, why would you care, and why would your body care about if there's microbial overgrowth in the gut? There is no need to heal in a way. So healing does not take place that much when you're in fight or flight. As a result, all these functions that are so good for us are downregulated because the system is in stress. It's focusing on only what is the most important, top priorities, and the rest, well, we don't have time for that right now. So when I got diagnosed with POTS, at first it was just the symptoms of the palpitations and the chest pain. I had a lot of other ones, but as the years kept passing, I noticed that I was adding a lot more new symptoms, a lot more diagnoses. And I also wonder if mostly things with my gut, a lot more like body pain than before, and a lot of other new diagnoses. And I wonder if that's partly also because of this. My body was so much in this fight or flight mode that it was just not prioritizing anything else. And as a result, I just kept getting worse and worse and worse. So now we know why fight or flight is so bad for us, both in the short term and in the long term. And of course, yes, we'd all love to be in rest and digest, but it's not like we could just choose to be in this and it'll just happen, right? That's not how the body works. So that's why also when sometimes people say, oh, just relax and calm down, it's frustrating to hear because it's not so easily done, right? So how do we do this? How do we gain more balance in our body? How do we make it so that we're not feeling like we're in fight or flight all the time? There's one little secret here, and that secret is called the vagus nerve. How does the vagus nerve relate to the autonomic nervous system? Well, the vagus nerve is the longest nerve of the autonomic nervous system, and it is one of the most important nerves in the body. Vagus literally means wandering in Latin. The nerve is named the wandering nerve for the lengthy path it takes from the brainstem all the way to the colon. This nerve carries an extensive range of signals from digestive system and our organs all the way to the brain and vice versa. So the information from this nerve is bidirectional, which means the communication goes from the brain down to the organs, as well as from the organs up to the brain. In fact, most of the traffic in the vagus nerve, 80%, travels upstream from our bodies to our brain. So how does this actually help us? Now, there's two hints here. One, looking at the vagus nerve itself, there's something called a low vagal tone. And that means that the vagus nerve isn't functioning as well as it should be. And these can actually be measured. And I probably will make another video discussing a little bit more about that. So if we have low vagal tone, then what we could do is there are strengthening exercises you could do for the vagus nerve. That's one part of it. The second part of it, we just talked that 80% of it is kind of the signals from the body to the mind, which is also the reason why, for example, when you're stressed, you can't just fake out your own mind saying, oh, I'm not stressed, it's fine, it's fine, it's fine. That's not, because your body is saying something else. It's telling a completely different story. And those signals are going from the body to the brain. So now we know that so much of the communication is actually upstream. What can we do with this information? We need to trick the body into being calm. So that means including more of the body. Slow, rhythmic, diaphragmatic breathing, cold showers, meditation, spending time in nature, mild exercise. All of these help with low vagal tone, with increasing that. And all of these are also messages that our body will then be sending to our brain. So they're extremely powerful. I know they sound basic and they sound like, oh, well, how can something like a cold shower help? But they really are powerful methods for the body. Now, one part of it is, of course, doing these kind of methods, but doing these actions is just not enough. We need to also look at the way we live our life, and we need to change the way we look at the way we live our life. So it's important to take a step back and evaluate commitments, habits, routines. What are the things that make you happy? What are the things that drain you emotionally or physically? Maybe you have a toxic relationship in your life, or you're the kind of person that's a perfectionist or an overachiever going 120 miles an hour. the reason I mentioned that is because that tends to be me. And I, looking at that, has made such a big difference in the way that I handle life and the way that I go about things. So some people might find it helpful to make new commitments or change their routines in order to include more of these actions in. Otherwise, these actions, just piling them on into an already busy calendar and into all the expectations we have of ourselves, it's not going to do anything. It's just going to be extra tasks to fill up the calendar. It's going to cause more stress. There's a lot of people that I know that include a lot of these actions in their day-to-day routine, but there's just also so much stress in their day-to-day life. But that's where stepping back and really simplifying and just stripping and going back down to basics is what helps. We need to go back to resting our bodies more and reassuring them so that our minds can also start to feel calm and so that the vagus nerve itself is strengthened. So I hope that you found this video helpful and informative. I'd love to hear your biggest takeaways down in the comments below. Let me know. How will you be strengthening your vagus nerve? What will you be reprioritizing? And if you want more videos like this, make sure you hit subscribe to my channel. And if you hit the bell, you'll get notifications each time I post a new video. So take care, and I'll see you next time.